What is going on, everyone? Welcome back to The World According to Briggs, and a video about seeing America. One of my favorite things to do is to travel in a way where I can actually see this great country. Flying is great if you need to be someplace in a hurry. I almost never have to be someplace in a hurry. When I'm traveling, if possible, I take the train. I love overnight trips. I get a room on the train, I relax, I read, I work on videos, and I spend an odd amount of time just staring out the window. Other times I drive, but really in the last few years I've kind of gotten away from that because I always have to do the driving and I don't get to take in the scenery as much as I'd like to. When I can, I take the train. So Amtrak is what I really like to do. Another great way to see America is cruise ships. Yeah, they don't just leave Miami and go straight to Caribbean islands. You have trips to Alaska, the Pacific Coast trips, and New England cruises. They also have river cruises, like on the Mississippi River and the Columbia River here in the Pacific Northwest, but I haven't been on those, and I really haven't heard good things. I've heard they're kind of boring. So those won't be included on this. I have been on all but one of these trips. Two were back before I had a channel, and I wasn't thinking about filming it other than a few pictures here or there. The one that I haven't been on, I have researched extensively over the last couple of years because I'm really looking forward to going on this trip, and I'll be going on it next year. All right, let's take a look at the 10 best trips to see America. Number 10. California State Highway 1. This is an amazing trip. The first time I took it was after I got out of basic training. I got to go home to Los Angeles before I had to report to Monterey at Fort Ord, California. Not knowing anything about driving up that far, I just knew Monterey and Fort Ord were on the coast. So I got on the coast and went up the highway. It took forever, but it was beautiful. Since then, I've probably taken it four other times. Not the whole route. It's a pretty long trip, but it's beautiful. The entire trip is 656 miles. It starts off down near Dana Point, California, which is south of Los Angeles and north of San Diego. And it ends halfway between San Francisco and the Oregon border. Now, it can go further if you want to get on the 101 and keep going north. That'll take you all the way to Canada. And it stays along the coast most of this trip. And when I say stays along the coast, I mean right there is the ocean. A cliff and water. No houses most of the time, hardly any trees. It's you and the ocean right outside your left window or your passenger window if you're coming south. During this trip, you go through Ventura, Santa Barbara, make your way up through San Luis Obispo, Morro Bay, which is beautiful. You'll go by Big Sur, eventually getting to Monterey, California, Santa Cruz, San Francisco, and then across the Golden Gate Bridge. Most people consider this one of the most scenic road trips in the country. Number 9, the Southwest Chief. The Southwest Chief is one of Amtrak's routes, whatever you want to call it. This train takes you across 8 states. You'll cross the Mississippi River, grasslands of Middle America, ranches, missions, pueblos, mountains, and deserts. It's all there for you to see. Very relaxing. You have stops in Fort Madison, Iowa, Dodge City, Kansas, Lawrence, Kansas, Trinidad, Colorado, Gallup, New Mexico, Albuquerque, New Mexico, Flagstaff, Arizona, a few other stops, and then finally in Los Angeles. When you get to Los Angeles, you should beeline it to LAX, the airport, and leave Los Angeles because Los Angeles sucks. Or you wait around for a couple hours at the train station, and take the next train out to like Northern California or Oregon or Washington. This train trip isn't as scenic as some of the other ones on this list. That's why this is at number 9. The other ones are later on in the list. But for some reason, it's more relaxing. I've taken it 3 times. One time, a man in the observation car of this train described it as getting a massage on your eyeballs and brain. You just sit there and relax. Number 8, Amtrak's Cardinal Line. This is one of the ones that I went on long before I started a channel. I don't think YouTube was a thing back then. I think it was around 92 or 93 I went on this trip. Did it twice, back-to-back years. One time I went during the fall, and the other time I went during dead of winter. They were both beautiful. I'm not sure which one was better. This train starts off in either Chicago or New York City. Along the way, you'll go through Indiana and stop in Indianapolis. You'll go right along the border of Kentucky and Ohio. You'll go through West Virginia, and this is, in my opinion, the best part. West Virginia has a lot of problems. Being an ugly state is not one of their problems. This is one of the most beautiful states we have. If you ever get a chance, just the West Virginia part is worth the trip. But I went from Chicago to Baltimore. Then the next time I went from Chicago and stopped in Philadelphia. The train leaves Chicago somewhere around 6:30 at night. My advice to you for this trip is to get one of the rooms so you could get a good night's sleep on the train. Lay down a bed, enjoy it, but wake up early because the scenery really gets good on this one around 5:30 in the morning. You're out of West Virginia by around noon, I'd say. It's still nice for a while through Virginia and stuff, but by the time you get to Baltimore and then Philadelphia, it's really nothing to see but city. So get up early, enjoy that part of the trip. Number 7. Take a Pacific Coastal Cruise. Cruise ships go everywhere these days. Normally, like I said at the beginning, they go to the Caribbean or you go to the Mediterranean, see the Greek Isles, things like that. But there's a lot of other cruises where you can see the United States. The first cruise we're going to talk about is the Pacific Coastal Cruise. Now, every cruise line does something like this, just about. Royal Caribbean, Norwegian Cruise Lines, they have really good ones. The stops are all different. One might go to San Francisco, all the way up to Oregon, and then Seattle from Los Angeles, and then one might start in San Diego, go down to Ensenada, Mexico, then you work your way up to Santa Barbara, you know, San Francisco, and on up. It just, they vary, but they go up and down the Pacific coast from Seattle or Vancouver, Canada, down to San Diego. This one is great for sightseeing and just enjoying a cruise and seeing America. With this cruise, it's nice if you can get a balcony cabin, but I mean, it's not necessary, especially if you go during the summer where most of the time you're going to be outdoors by the pool, around the deck, doing things, and you'll really just use your room for sleeping, showering, getting ready, and going to do something on the cruise ship. There's other cruises where you definitely want to get a balcony. We'll talk about those later. But if you don't know, an inside cab without a balcony or a window, they're really cheap and it's a really affordable trip to do. But if you can swing it, definitely get a balcony. These range in duration from 9 days to, I've seen them as low as 4 days. And if you do decide to get the inside cabin, you're looking at a cruise that may only set you back about $450 per person. Number 6, the Blue Ridge Parkway. This is a road trip that's insanely beautiful. This is a 469-mile road trip, or 755 kilometers. It goes through 29 North Carolina and Virginia counties. For the most part, this one runs the spine of the Blue Ridge Mountains. That's why it got its name, the Blue Ridge Parkway. It starts up not too far from Charlottesville, Virginia, and ends past Asheville, North Carolina, near a place called Cherokee, North Carolina. At some point, you'll go through a place called Fancy Gap, Virginia. Don't know why I love the name of that place, I just love it. Fancy Gap. During this trip, you'll go through, or at least be near, the Shenandoah National Park, Smoky Mountains National Park, and Mount Mitchell State Park, which is actually the highest peak east of the Mississippi River. Elevation 6,684 feet. This one can get a little rough during the winter, so I'd suggest summer or spring. Number 5, take a New England cruise. All right, back to the cruise ships. Just about every cruise line does the New England, Canada thing. It's mostly New England, and then they always stop at least one time in Canada. In case you don't know, there's a law that's actually suspended now because of COVID, so the cruise ships can start sailing again. But there's a law that says any cruise ship leaving the United States has to make at least one stop in a foreign country. So, like, if you're doing Alaska, you gotta go to Victoria, Canada. Something like that. Or the ones that are down on the Pacific Coast, normally you have to go to, like, Ensenada, Mexico, but right now that's suspended. Anyway, the New England cruises start from all kinds of places. Boston, New York City, Baltimore. I've seen a couple that start in New Jersey, but they go up the coast and they stop at places like Bar Harbor, Maine, Portland, Maine, Newport, Rhode Island, Virginia, and some even start off in Fort Lauderdale and take you all the way up the East Coast and drop you off in Montreal and you fly home from there. These ones aren't sailing right now because Canada's not letting any cruise ships come in because of COVID, but when they kick back up, this is a good one. They don't sail during the winter, so try and get in there in the summer or spring, maybe even fall. Number 4, the Empire Builder. The Empire Builder is one of my favorite trains. It can start off in Chicago, Seattle, or Portland, Oregon. What happens is one half of the train leaves Seattle and the other half leaves Portland, Oregon, and they meet up in Spokane and become one train and they head to Chicago. Or if they're coming back from Chicago somewhere around midnight on like the third day, they split off. One half goes to Seattle, the other half goes to Portland, Oregon. But this is a great trip. Lots to see on this one. You go through the Rockies up in Idaho and Montana and it is beautiful. I've gone on this one 3 times and I've gone in the winter 1 time. The winter was amazing. So beautiful. When you get to the North Dakota and Eastern Montana part, that kind of sucks because it's kind of flat and there's really nothing to see. Good time to read a book. But when you hit the Rockies or you're going through Minnesota, Wisconsin, it is beautiful. I like going to Chicago on this one instead of going to Seattle from Chicago because you get to the Rockies and you see all that beauty early in the morning and get to see it all day. When you're going the other direction, you usually get to the Rockies right around 4 in the afternoon, and by the time you're in it and seeing all the cool stuff, it's getting pretty dark and you kind of miss out. Again, get the room on the train, spend the night, enjoy it. And now they brought their food back to, for a while there, they went to this like frozen stuff that they just heat up for you. It sucked. It was horrible. Well, they went back to actually having a cook and a kitchen in one of the cars, and you could order steaks, pancakes, whatever you want. Well, I should say whatever's on the menu. And it's decent food. I mean, far better than what they were serving before, and far better than you're going to get on an airplane. But this one, when you get into the mountainous part of this one, you want to get a GoPro, suction it to the window, get a bunch of footage, and just relax. Number 3, the Vermonter. The Vermonter is a really bad name for a train, but it goes through Vermont, so that's why they named it that. I think something like the New England Express would have been great, something like that, but it's called the Vermonter. That's the only bad thing about this train. It is beautiful. I don't care if you go summer, winter, fall is probably the best. This is a great train trip to take. It starts in Washington, D.C. about 8 in the morning and arrives in St. Albans, Vermont around 9 o'clock at night. My suggestion is get off in Montpelier. The rest of it's nothing special. Montpelier's worth a day or so's visit. I would stop there, definitely. This one's one of the ones where you need a good camera or a good phone that takes good pictures. Definitely up your Instagram game just taking this trip. It's beautiful. This isn't an overnight one, so you don't have to worry about getting the bedroom or anything like that. Just get a seat and go. Spend the night in Montpelier, head on back. Number 2. Amtrak's California Zephyr. California Zephyr is probably the best train trip you could take. It starts in Chicago, like most of them do, and it goes all the way to the West Coast around San Francisco. Most people will get off in Sacramento, grab another train, whatever they're gonna do. That's what I've done twice. Now this one, you leave Chicago and it's kind of boring. You cross the Mississippi River around 5 or 6 the first night, but it's pretty boring that first day because it's just farmland. Second day, when you wake up, be ready to be amazed. This brings me to a point. If you're just going to take this trip, just blow off Chicago and fly to Denver and get on the train there. The train leaves around 8 in the morning, which is perfect because it takes about the entire day to get through the Rocky Mountains. This is definitely one of the best trips I've ever taken in my life. The scenery is so mind-blowing in parts, it almost seems like it was put together for a movie, like it's fake, but it's 100% real. I took this trip when my son got out of the Army in 2019. He got out in Chicago. Well, he got out in New York. We met in Chicago, got on the train, and took this train home, and it was awesome. Definitely one of the best trips I've ever had. I mean, besides the fact my son's out of the military and with me on this trip, it was just awesome. I've been on a lot of train trips, and this one, they really know people are there just to see the Rockies. So before you leave, that train gets all of its windows cleaned. Now, I've seen them clean windows on other trips, but it's usually, you know, one or two guys just kind of going down and they barely do a good job. These guys were making sure the windows were perfect for this part of the trip. It was pretty cool and they did a good job. I wanted to go outside and tip them, but by the time I realized that, they were gone and I don't know. It was just, hey, I was kind of disappointed I didn't tip those guys. They did a really good job. I don't think window cleaners for Amtrak get tipped a lot. They probably would have been confused, but I wanted to. But like I said, the best way to do this one is get on in Denver, go through the Rockies, get off in Reno. Now, if you want to stay and see even more beautiful mountains, go all the way to Sacramento. But after you've seen the Rockies, the Sierra Nevadas seem kind of weak. I know that sounds strange because the Sierra Nevadas are beautiful, but after you've been through the Rockies, and then the next day you're going through the Sierra Nevadas, it's just not the same. This one's definitely one you want to get a room for because you're going to be spending a couple nights on this train. If you do get the room, make sure it's one on the top level. Don't get that family bedroom, which is down on the bottom because, you know, you're at like ground level with everything and you don't get a good view. And then you want to go to the viewing car. But as soon as you hit the Rockies, that thing is standing room only, just filled with people that don't have rooms of their own. They're sitting in coach or whatever. This is definitely one you should have on your bucket list. All right, before we get to number one, don't forget, we have another channel called On This Day. We're going to get back on doing those in a couple weeks here. Kind of been on hiatus, but we'll be back at it. While you're at it, don't forget to give this video a big thumbs up. Subscribe if you haven't. All right, on to number one. And number one. An Alaskan cruise. So there are several different Alaskan cruises. I mean, you could stop at Juneau, Ketchikan, Sitka, Skagway, Icy Strait Point. There's all kinds of places you can stop here, but the main attraction is the glaciers. You take a cruise and you make sure it's one of the ones going to Glacier Bay. Look for Glacier Bay on whatever cruise itinerary you're looking at. I mean, the other glaciers are nice, but Glacier Bay is mind-blowing. Now, the reason I say you gotta look and make sure it's going there, this is actually like a national park, Glacier Bay is, so they only allow like 2 cruise ships in a day. The other ones, I mean, cruise ships are going by them all the time, but this one section, just to kind of preserve it as best they can, it's only 2 cruise ships a day. I mean, the glaciers are neat and everything like that, but you get to stop at these really historic towns like Skagway, Juneau. Juneau's the only state capital you can't drive to. You gotta fly or take a boat to get there. Ketchikan is amazing. It's a beautiful little town. Icy Strait Point's kind of cool. They got this little weird town called Hunan. I was there. Wasn't much to it. The people were extremely nice, and a guy was building a totem pole, or making a totem pole, whatever you want to call it. It was kind of cool, but it was just a little nothing fishing town. Sitka, I haven't been to. I will actually be there a week from today, actually. Yeah, today. A week from today, I'll be in Sitka, Alaska. Remember when I said you can get a inside cabin and save some money on other cruises? Don't do that on this one. Make sure you have a balcony. There's plenty of places to look at the scenery from the decks and stuff like that, but it's cold, and it's better if you have your balcony right there. You can go in, get warm, because it can get cold up there, obviously. Just get a cabin with a balcony. Save up a couple extra months if you got to. The best time to take this one is in June or July. August, it starts getting a little cold, and you run into risks of rain, and then September and October, and I'm going in mid-September again, and I already know the weather is not going to be ideal. But that's why they have a bunch of bars on a cruise ship. All right, everyone, so this is a little different than our usual stuff here. I would like to do more travel-type videos. If you guys get into that and we get enough views on this, I'd love to do more. Let me know in the comments section below. Make sure you give this video a big thumbs up. Have a great day, and be nice to each other.